He's a Dutch inventor and environmentalist, a former aerospace engineer, and the CEO of The Ocean Cleanup. TEDx speaker, Forbes 30 under 30, Young Entrepreneur of the Year, European Entrepreneur of the Year, the list goes on. But before I invite Boyan Slat to the stage, let's watch a little video.
There's bad news for our ocean.
A patch of floating trash and plastic in the Pacific Ocean is getting worse by the day.
The problem is even worse than originally thought.
To quantify a problem of this size, we had to do research at a scale that had never been done before.
To truly rid the oceans of plastic, what we need to do is two things. One, we need to clean up the legacy pollution. Today, we'll be launching the world's first ocean cleanup system heading towards the Great Pacific Garbage Patch.
So there you have it. We have just passed the Golden Gate Bridge, the iconic moment. It's absolutely incredible.
Every hour is a small victory, and every plastic pea that we all catch is a small victory.
We now have a system that's catching plastic. Two, we need to close the tap. The world's first scalable river plastic solution. Right now, Interceptor 1 is cleaning in Indonesia. Interceptor 2 is cleaning in Malaysia. Imagine if we do get this done, we could truly make our oceans clean again.
Good to see you.
Really nice film.
Thank you.
Now, I know that the two of you know each other. How did you meet?
We had to meet, you know. Boyan, when he was 16, launched the project. People were laughing at him, said it's impossible. And when I hear something like that, I say, that's somebody to help. And we got in touch, and we spoke a lot about how to find sponsors, how to gain credibility, and, well, I love what he's doing. He's a great guy.
We even met when you were flying above the Great Pacific Garbage Patch.
So exactly.
Exactly.
Yeah. Super. I understand that your relationship goes back quite a while. You've got a affiliation to the ocean, the two of you, Bertrand, with your father's projects that he did over the years. And I understand that you've got a really special announcement linked to something you said earlier on today.
Yeah, exactly. But you know, Boyan went through about the same phases at Solar Impulse, and probably a lot of you do the same. We do a first prototype in order to learn, and then we make the second prototype that really works. Solar Impulse had two prototypes. We went around the world with the second one. Boyan had the first cleanup system in the open ocean, and now he's doing the interceptor, where he's collecting the waste directly where the rivers are bringing them to the ocean. And he's showing that it is now a business model that works. So when I knew that Boyan would be here, I thought, this is really the solution that we have to announce today. And we have put the experts on your interceptor model. They have judged that it was profitable, that it was credible, that it protects the environment, the three criteria. So you got the label of the Solar Impulse Foundation, and I give it to you officially now.
Oh. Thank you.
So you joined the 1,000 solutions that have the label.
Brilliant.
Congratulations, and
thank you so much.
Really thank you for what you're doing.
Thank you too.
Fantastic. Cheers.
Thanks very much.
And now I think it's your time to give your speech.
Okay.
It is. Yeah, we're going to stay and have a bit of a conversation. Bertrand, thank you so much for joining us.
With
congratulations,
pleasure.
Boyan. That's an amazing achievement. So, where do we start? So you're on an incredible mission to clean the oceans, and I understand that you started with the oceans and now you've moved to the rivers.
Sure.
Why the swap?
Yeah, so it wasn't actually a swap. It was more of an expansion of the scope. So We started the ocean cleanup to rid the world's oceans of plastic. And of course, we started with the cleanup side of the legacy because we really felt that that was the most neglected side of the issue. Many people were already doing great work on the prevention side, yet nobody was dealing with the trash, which was already accumulated in the ocean and is just there to stay forever. I mean, when we do our expeditions, we really found plastic going back to the 1970s, still in recognizable shape. So, just like CO2, it's very persistent, this pollutant, and we also have to deal with, say, negative emissions. But then, of course, there's still the emissions themselves. And at some point in time, I think 2015, we realized, well, if we don't do anything on that side, it's just not going fast enough, and we just have to keep cleaning forever, which would be, you know, we would like to do some other things in our lives. So then we thought, well, can we use our knowledge, our abilities with our team to also do something about the inflow side? And that led to discovering that just 1% of rivers do 80% of plastic floating into the ocean.
Literally 1%.
1% of rivers. So that's still 1,000 rivers. So it's still, you know, you need something scalable. But it's not something that we cannot do. I think it really sounds quite doable. So that's why we then developed the Interceptor, being something that's really serious manufacturable, so we can just make 1,000 of them and really tackle these rivers one by one.
So how does the Interceptor work? This is the product that's in the rivers, collecting the plastic and rubbish from the rivers and then making sure that doesn't go to the sea. How does it work? Is it like those machines, you know, the ones that you see in the when you go go to the games? Yeah, and they have the claws. Does it do that?
No.
Okay.
That would not be a bad idea, actually. Maybe I should invite you to the engineering team one time.
They'd kick me out.
Yeah. Well, we could try. But so the way it works is that it's a device that's moored at the mouth of the river, so it's not moving. It's static. It uses the flow of the river to bring the plastic in, and then uses a conveyor belt to scoop the plastic out. And it then distributes the plastic automatically across different dumpsters, which is on a barge. You can then periodically take the barge out, bring it to the side of the river, empty it, put it back in, just like you would empty a vacuum cleaner, for example.
So wait a minute. Simple. It's a vacuum cleaner. I'm going to really bastardize this. So basically, it's a vacuum cleaner using the current of the river, so you don't have to have any suction,
to
collect the stuff and then bring it in, so that you can take it out.
Correct, and it's fully solar powered, so it's solar panels and batteries, can operate day and night. It's autonomous, so it just does its thing. And again, we designed it to be able to work not in just one specific river, but really in all of these, most of these 1,000 rivers.
So what's the difference between the rivers that would mean that the design would need to be more flexible?
Well, so rivers are, each river is actually very different. You have different flow speeds of the water. You have different widths. You have tidal rivers, non-tidal rivers. So we're really trying to design something that could work in all of these different conditions.
And so when you've collected all this plastic, what do you do with it? Do you send it off to recycling plants? Like, what happens with it? Now we've got it out.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yes.
Thank you for making the river is much more beautiful. I can, you know, when you get to the Thames, I might be able to swim in it.
Right.
But what happens with all the material that's then collected?
Yeah, of course, that's of critical importance, because if it just gets dumped somewhere, you know, back into nature and the river, I mean, it would.
Then the oceans are clean, but we've now got a new problem.
It would just be a very sustainable business model, just keep catching the same piece of plastic. So we don't want to do that. So the idea is that we work with partners to really make sure that it goes, that we can track the plastic all the way in the value chain. Right now, it's really dependent on the best locally available solution. So it could be waste to energy, could be recycling, could be, you know, well-managed landfill. But the idea is, of course, that eventually by having our interceptors there, that it will also incentivize the creation of better infrastructure locally. And actually, that's what we now see happening with the first systems that we deployed, that suddenly you see these sorting centers popping up, and because there's actually an incentive to do something with that material.
So you've really thought about the end-to-end life cycle, not just the initial, I mean, it starts with the initial problem of we need to get this material out of the ocean, not going into the ocean in the first place, but you've thought beyond that to say, what happens when we collect it? It looks like that's now creating...
Yeah, well, I think it's just our responsibility, and if we, and actually we said, well, we're not going to deploy unless there is a waste management solution that's up to standards, because, you know, would be pretty bad if it ends up back in the environment. So that's, of course, on the river side. And then on the ocean side, the idea is actually that we go one step further and actually bring the plastic back to the consumer by making really durable, sustainable, desirable products from the plastic that we get out of the ocean. So we're now trialing the first product, and I think by September we'll be able to bring that to the world. And I think it's going to be something quite fun, and the hope is that we can actually help the continuation of the cleanup with the funding model that creates.
You really thought of everything, like no rock left unturned here. And in the oceans, are you using the same sorts of technology in terms of how that solution works that you're using with the interceptors in the rivers, or is it quite different?
Yeah, no, it's quite different, because the main engineering challenge on rivers is just to have it be scalable and working all these different conditions. On the oceans, it's much more about how to make it durable. You have waves of 14 meters. You don't have that in rivers. And on the other side, also to have something that can really concentrate the plastic and hold on to it for a very long amount of time. Because when you think about it, the garbage patch is really fast. It's three times the size of France. But then in terms of the density, it's not an island you can walk on. It's really dispersed. So you first somehow have to concentrate it before you come by with your boat and bring it to land. Because if you would just have to directly scoop it out with a boat with your funfair device, yeah.
You should put that on your ideas list.
Yeah.
Heard it here first, guys. If you see him come up with the claw,
yes.
Lovelda's idea.
Yeah. But of course, the point is that would be really expensive to just directly scoop it out of the water.
See, that's why I'm not on the engineering team. I come up with expensive ideas.
Yeah, I mean, happens. So the cleanup systems, they really, their core functionality is to concentrate the plastic first before we take it out. So the idea is you deploy a fleet, you leave them out there for many months, and then only periodically you have to come by, scoop it out, and bring it to land for recycling.
So it's literally out there for months at a time?
Yeah, so the systems would just stay out there, just like the plastic, they would just stay in the garbage patch, and they just do the work for us.
So I'm going to get a little bit cheeky, not too cheeky, but it's a big, vast idea to decide that you're going to clean up something like the ocean. You could have started with a river, maybe, you know, just for next time.
Right.
But for the, like, to clean up something as big as the ocean is a good idea. Is a big idea. How on earth do you fund something like that?
Yeah. Well, there's partly an open question. Yet so far, we've been mostly funded by donations, so we're a nonprofit. So actually, last year, we had more than 1 million people actually contributing to the mission.
Are these individuals or organizations?
Individuals.
Really?
Yeah. Right.
Is there a link?
Yeah, so theoceancleanup.com. Feel free to help there.
Let me write that one down.
But of course, what we hope is that once we really get to scaling, that it will... that first of all, we also have that revenue model with products that we make from the plastic we take out, as well as partnerships with industry, with companies, for branding's sake, or because they actually have a meaningful contribution in kind to do our work.
How do those conversations with organizations go? Hi, I'm cleaning the oceans. Can I have some money? Like, how are there specific...
Exactly like that.
Really? Yeah. like, because I would kind of just be really overwhelmed with having that conversation with an organization. And, do you find that it's really simple and straightforward to demonstrate? Were there any things that they needed to have in place before they'd take you in and say, well, let's sit and have a serious conversation?
Yeah, so of course it morphs over time. At the beginning, it's really just about... making sure that people share the belief in the mission, in the team, and gradually more and more it becomes, okay, well, how many tons of plastic can you take out for every euro that I put into the project, right? So this is a natural evolution. It's an illusion to think you can raise everything at the beginning. The funding you can raise is really directly coupled to the stage of the project. So it's basically the cycle of making an achievement, communicating about the achievement, then finding the support on the wave of the attention that gives, and with the resources that you get through that, make the next achievement, etc. So it's just this sort of the spiral staircase, and of course the steps become bigger and bigger, but that's how it worked for us so far.
And I know it wasn't always smooth sailing. Bertrand kind of alluded to the first iteration wasn't necessarily perfect. There were a few gaps.
Right.
How do you recover from that and keep going such that you go with the vision where you have to keep tweaking? Because it's not a small thing where you can, it's a big thing to go out and even just put it in the ocean and get it going. So you've got to get this thing pretty much there in order to do it. So each iteration presumably is not cheap.
Yes. So that's a bit of the difficult thing with what we do. It's not like software where you can just have this whole new iteration in a few hours. It's the iteration cycle is about a year for big ocean hardware. So everything the steps take long and they're also quite costly. So, and a lot of these things you can't really scale down in terms of how the plastic behaves in the ocean and things like that. So unfortunately, you just have to learn by doing, and that sometimes causes very painful situations. I mean, 1 year ago, it was like probably the darkest moment we've ever had, where on the ocean side, we saw that the system wasn't working and then broke into two because we had a bit of a structural failure there. So we were forced to bring it back to shore to really completely reimagine the design there. And then at the same time, you also had this river project. Well, we had one river machine, and that had been stuck in customs for more than a year.
Yes.
So, something with not wanting to bribe people and things like that. So that was really, really quite difficult. And then, fast forward 1 year later, we got the ocean system to work, and we now have two interceptors that are cleaning thousands of kilos of plastic every day. So it was a important year, but we survived last year.
Yeah. So the interceptor's working, the ocean project is working as well. What's the scale-up goals? Like, where do you think you'll be in, 5 years?
Yeah. So on the ocean side, we're now developing what we call system number two, which will be basically a bigger version that will be fully operational, and that should form the blueprint for the whole fleet. So we hope to launch that next year, and then from that scale up to a whole fleet of many of these systems, the goal being to clean up 50% of this garbage patch every 5 years. So that's on the cleanup side. Then on the river side, this year is really about preparing for scale up, so sending up the right partnerships with waste management companies, with manufacturers, with funders, to be able to do that scale up. This year we hope to deploy an additional 10 rivers, but it's really just about getting the model right, preparing the team for scale up. But because the goal is of course much bigger, we hope to get to those 1,000 rivers, doing 80% of the pollution in the next 5 years. So we won't be bored in the next
I was going to say, the team's grown really quickly as well. How have you managed that? You've got 100 people now, haven't you?
Yeah. Again, that's kind of trial and error as well. Definitely made many mistakes, but the team now is it's really, really great. And actually, we're still hiring quite a few people. So again, on our website, feel free to have
a
look there.
That's theoceancleanup.com. Not that we're doing any plugs at all here at the moment. What does sustainability mean to you?
Yeah, so if you look at the the past few hundred years of humanity, we've made tremendous progress in terms of health, wealth, education, violence, extreme poverty. I mean, all of these trends are extremely positive, thanks to our ability to collaborate effectively, thanks to our economic system and institutions, as well as thanks to our ability to imagine things that don't exist yet. It has never been a better time to be alive for humans than today. Mm-hmm. Yet, in that development, we've prioritized our own well-being over overall well-being, which is, I think, a very understandable thing. but that did create quite a few negative side effects when it comes to especially the environment, where we see very similar sort of hockey stick trends, but in the opposite direction, of the amount of plastic in the ocean, the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere, etc. So I think what our major challenge in this century, and kind of to answer your question, that to me means what this is sustainability, is to transition our civilization into something that can still exist in the next century, which means closing that gap between having technologies that are both good for ourselves as well as good for the environment. I mean, it shouldn't be a choice whether you help yourself or help the environment. Like when I now want to travel somewhere, people like traveling, so that's good for yourself, but you're forced to kind of do damage to the environment. So that's why I'm not a big believer in sort of the voluntary constraints of saying, well, we should try and fly less or eat in a different way or not use cars anymore. I think the future will much more be about zero emissions airplanes, about plant-based and artificial meat, about electric cars. So it's really about developing a technological society that works both for humans as well as for the environment, which I think is really the greatest challenge of the century, and that's what sustainability is for me.
So how do we, how do you think we go from taking these ideas of sustainability and environmental issues from a luxury, because some could argue, look, you're living in a developing country, you've got all of these luxuries, you're quite comfortable. How do you take it from that kind of luxury issue to an immediate need for people to do something different?
Yes. But I suppose that's what really underlies the entire environmental movement. I mean, the reason why in late 60s, early 70s, the environmental movement was born wasn't because it was sort of the worst the environment had ever been. Actually, certain smog and things like pollution in rivers was already going down for decades. But it was really about humanity reaching a level of affluence that afforded us the luxury to actually care about things beyond our own well-being. And so I don't think it's necessarily such a bad thing that that environmentalism starts as a sort of a luxury thing, but of course the hope is that by having the more affluent people invest in those kind of solutions, eventually due to economies of scale and due to learning curves, the cost will come down for it to be really accessible for everyone. And of course, that's what we see with solar. That's what we see with electric cars, with China being the greatest market now, and soon that will expand to India, etc. So any novel technology will usually start in sort of the higher price point, but it's really about people that can afford that to bring those cost curves down and make it accessible to everyone.
Make sure that everybody can get access to it. So what is it, how can people help who've been listening today, and I know we've been doing our little selfless plugs, but how can people help get involved with the ocean cleanup? Is there any support in particular that you're looking for at the moment? There's a couple of people here who may be able to help.
Sure, yeah. So it's really about having the right partnerships that we can scale this, finding the governmental support to be able to implement these interceptors, as well as setting up the partnerships for funding to be able to deploy all these hundreds of interceptors in the coming years. So with any of that, as well as just individual donations or reserving actually the first product that we're going to launch this year, all of that you can definitely help with by visiting our website, theoceancleanup.com. So.
And you've got an exhibition stand here this weekend as well?
I'm
calling it the weekend.
Yes.
Is it tomorrow and Saturday?
Right.
It's open, so you can go around and I do have little bits that they can. There's no jaw. There's no claw to go look at.
No idea we'll be there, but definitely a few great colleagues of ours. So
yeah. So do go and check out the stand. It's not open today, but it will be open tomorrow and Saturday. Boyan, thank you so much for today, ladies and gentlemen. Please give a warm round of applause to Boyan Slat.
Thank you. Yeah.